Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In this lecture, we will discuss pharmacotherapy of glaucoma. Glaucoma is a group of diseases characterized by a progressive form of optic nerve damage. And before going into the details of the management of glaucoma, you must have a baseline knowledge of pathophysiology of this condition. Okay, how this condition will arise. It will arise either by increased production of aqueous humor or there is some decreased drainage of aqueous humor. So our aim of therapy should be, number one, either we should decrease the production of aqueous humor or we should go for to increase the drainage of aqueous humor. The site of formation and pathway of drainage of aqueous humor is illustrated in this figure. Major amount of aqueous humor, around 90% of aqueous humor will drain through the trabecular route, while only 10% fluid passes into the connective tissue spaces within the ciliary muscles. And then from ciliary muscles into suprachoroidal vessels and then into episcleral vessels. And this route is also known as uvoscleral outflow. So mainly it is drained through trabecular meshwork. Here, how we will classify the drugs used in glaucoma. According to our first aim of therapy, that we want to decrease the production of aqueous humor. We will decrease production by ABC. ABC means A for adrenergic agonist, which includes apraclonidine and brimonidine, and then beta blockers. Most importantly, drug used is timolol, and then carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, which include dorzolamide and prinzolamide. And here are some drugs which can increase the outflow. We have some miotics like pilocarpine, carbacol, physostigmine, icothiopate, demicarion. And prostaglandin analogs, especially F2 alpha, latanoprost. And then adrenergic agonist, we have non-selective and selective alpha 2 agonists. Non-selective we have epinephrine and dipivefrine. Now we will discuss the beneficial role of alpha 2 agonist in management of glaucoma, and we have apraclonidine and brimonidine. Apraclonidine is a polar clonidine congener which does not cross the blood brain barrier, but applied topically, that is 0.5 to 1% strength, and it will lower intraocular tension by 25%. It decreases aqueous production by primarily acting on alpha 2 receptors. And then we have brimonidine. Brimonidine is a recently introduced clonidine congener, is more alpha 2 selective and more lipophilic than apraclonidine. It lowers intraocular tension by 20 to 27%. How? By reducing aqueous production and by increasing uvoscleral outflow. Alpha 2 agonists have some side effects. They may lead to CNS depression and apnea in neonates, and sometimes mydriasis, eyelid retraction, conjunctival blenching, hyperemia, which are less prominent. Another important drug group which is used in the management of glaucoma is beta blockers. Topical beta blockers are one of the first line drugs, and in contrast to miotics, the beta blockers do not affect pupil size, tone of ciliary muscles or outflow facility, but lower intraocular tension. How? By reducing aqueous humor production. And it results from down regulation of adenylyl cyclase due to beta 2 receptor blockage in the ciliary epithelium, and secondary effect due to reduction in ocular blood flow. So it will reduce aqueous humor production by two means. They are as effective as miotics and produce less ocular side effects. Timolol is the prototype of ocular beta blocker. It is non-selective and has no local anesthetic or intrinsic sympathomimetic activity. Then we have a selective antagonist bitaxolol. It is beta 1 selective blocker, offering the advantage of less bronchopulmonary and less cardiac, central and metabolic side effects. It will also reduce sodium, calcium influx, and it will play its beneficial role in management of glaucoma. Oral carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like acetazolamide can also be used for the management of glaucoma, especially before or after surgery, but it has many side effects like paresthesia, anorexia, hypokalemia, acidosis, malaise, and depression. So systemic side effects are more with acetazolamide. To avoid systemic side effects, dorzolamide and brinzolamide, which are topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors, they are more in use nowadays. And they have some side effects, but they are not very bothersome, like ocular stinging, burning, itching, and bitter taste. But we can avoid systemic side effects by the use of these topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors like dorzolamide and brinzolamide. Nowadays, prostaglandin F2 alpha analogs have replaced most of the drugs which were used previously for the management of glaucoma. And latanoprost, a very important drug in this group, it is instilled in the eye. And this PGF2 alpha derivative has shown efficacy similar to timolol. It can reduce intraocular tension by 25 to 30%, and effect is well sustained over long term, and it reduces intraocular tension in normal pressure glaucoma also. It's very beneficial. So ocular irritation and pain are frequent, but no systemic side effects are reported with prostaglandin F2 alpha analogs. There may be blurring of vision, increased iris pigmentation, thickening and darkening of eyelashes have occurred in some cases. Because of good efficacy, once daily application and absence of systemic complications, prostaglandin analogs have become the first choice drugs in developed countries. Epinephrine and dabigatran are also used in the management of glaucoma. Epinephrine is applied 0.5 to 1% strength topically, and it will lower intraocular tension, but response is variable. Why? Because of poor corneal penetration. The intraocular tension reduction is due to increased uveal scleral outflow and beta-2 receptor mediated increased hydraulic conductivity of trabecular filtering cells, and there will be reduction in aqueous formation, and it can result from alpha-2 and alpha-1 receptor activation in ciliary body. While dabigatran is a prodrug of adrenaline, it can penetrate cornea and is hydrolyzed by the esterases present there into epinephrine. So better tolerated and longer acting than adrenaline, and dabigatran still produces significant ocular side effects. It is used only as add-on therapy in poorly controlled patients. The current approach to treatment of open-angle glaucoma can be summarized as start with monotherapy, either with latanoprost or a topical beta blocker. If target intraocular tension is not attained, either change over to the alternative drug or use both of the above drugs. Concurrently, brimonidine, dorzolamide, dabigatran are used only when there are contraindications to prostaglandin analogs or beta blockers, or to supplement their action. Topical meiotics and oral acetazolamides are added only as the last resort. Now we will come to manage ankle closure glaucoma. It occurs in individuals with a narrow iridocorneal angle and shallow anterior chamber. The intraocular tension remains normal until an attack is precipitated. How attack will be precipitated? Usually by mydriasis. What will happen? The intraocular tension rises rapidly to a very high values, up to 40 to 60 millimeter of mercury. So vigorous therapy is needed here. What should we do? Hypertonic mannitol 20% can be given intravenously to decongest the eye, or acetazolamide 0.5 gram intravenously followed by oral twice daily is started. And then we can give meiotics Once the intraocular tension starts falling due to the above IV therapy, pilocarpine 1 to 4% is instilled after every 10 minutes and then at longer intervals. First of all, in second slide, I show you a figure where the site of formation and pathway of drainage of aqueous humor was shown, and now here the sites of action of anti-glaucoma drugs have also been shown. That there are some drugs which can increase aqueous humor inflow, which includes beta blockers and alpha 2 agonist and carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. These are the drugs which will decrease the aqueous humor formation. And to increase the drainage, to increase trabecular outflow, we have muscarinic agonist, and to increase uveoscleral outflow, we have prostaglandins agonist.